Well, this year marks a very special milestone for one of our most loved people here at Nine. Entertainment editor Richard Wilkins is celebrating 35 years at the network and in that time has become a legend of the industry. Last weekend he celebrated with friends, colleagues and celebrities, and this afternoon we wanted to have a look back at an extraordinary career. Dickie, welcome. Congratulations.
Oh, thank you.
It's so special.
Well, it's a long time, isn't it?
No, it's not.
It's a blink of the eye. Well, it's a fair while at the crease, but, you know, no 2 days have ever been the same. And, you know, I feel myself extremely lucky to work with so many beautiful people over the years, to have been given so many opportunities and to have had so many laughs along the way.
And we're lucky to have you. Tell me about the very first day that you went on air at Nine.
Well, I was hired at this wonderful place to host MTV Australia, which... Mr. Packer had bought as a sort of a late-night fill-in, because television didn't used to run all night back in the day. And I think he saw it as a sort of a late-night thing, that to flick the switch at 10:30 or whatever it was, and MTV would go through the night. But it soon became apparent that that we needed to produce our own show here. So MTV, for 6 years to the day, was a late-night rock and roll entertainment, live-to-air, simulcast with FM radio, music show, and I had the honour of hosting every single one of those episodes.
And before that, you knew Peter Overton.
Yeah, well, I came to Australia in 1980 with my little band, and having left Teachers College and uni, and, you know, toured around New Zealand a few times, and got a job in, when the band all fell to bits, in working in radio, and then a new thing called Club Superstation came along, which was the first satellite television in Australia. And Pete Overton and Graham McNeish used to... We were broadcasting... It was called Club Superstation, to 3.5 pubs and clubs around New South Wales. They were calling the Dogs, you know, say, all right, we're coming back to Dapto for the fourth very shortly, but meantime, let's go to Richard Wilkins to play some music clips. I go, oh, thanks very much, lads. Yeah, well, INXS have got a new video from their Listen Like Thieves album. It's called What You Need Here. Oh, Richard, oh, don't worry about that. We're back to the races in Dapto. So, you know,
How old were you and Pete?
Oh, God, we were just babies, obviously. But we had about 6 months of that. For me, it was a great learning curve to notch up some flying hours with no one watching, fortunately.
So, so cool.
Wasn't very cool.
No, it's great to know that two of you have gone through your career together.
And remain great mates.
Yeah. You get the front row seats. You go to gigs that most of us would only ever dream of, and get to talk to celebrities that we don't ever dream of. Have you got an all-time favourite interview or gig?
Oh, goodness me. You sort of take it for granted, because it just sort of happens. And having played in bands and seen the industry from every conceivable angle, I don't think I've ever been overawed. But I do remember, you know, a couple of cool things going to a Bon Jovi gig in upstate New York at Saratoga Parkway, where the Hell's Angels were the security guys.
Oh,
there.
Oh, my goodness.
Massive audience there. And I was sitting on a road case on the side of the stage with Richie Sambora's guitars all lined up, and back when they used to have Bon Jovi down the front of the stage, remember that? And you know, and then getting a lift back to New York with them that night. That was quite the trip. Yeah, and the bar, Richie, come on, man, let's go. I was going to get, you know, come down somehow, and he said, no, man, come on the tour bus, it's going to be a great time. I was like, oh, okay.
You survived it.
You survived it. But you know, it was great.
And even
so many wonderful things like that happen.
Even last weekend, Robbie Williams, you were with him.
Well, yeah, Rob, that was a lovely job to get Robbie Williams in Melbourne, where he's shooting his movie Better Man, and they wanted to get some crowd scenes, so they did a couple of gigs, and Robbie performed for an hour, but it wasn't a normal show, so they asked me to come down and interview Rob on stage and sort of, you know, make it seem like it was all supposed to be that way. But they were shooting some scenes, a couple of Take That performances that he wasn't part of. It doesn't look like that anymore.
But
that was great. Rob, you know, Robbie's become a bit of a mate over the years.
Well, that's,
you know,
we've
crossed paths so many times.
You've got so many celebrities who you've worked with alongside that they're now friends.
Michael Bublé,
Delta.
Well, Bublé's become a mate. Delta's more family than a friend. Yeah, I think some people... I mean, I don't go out of my way to try and make friends with everybody.
But it's a reflection of how much they adore you.
Well, Michael, I remember when we first had Michael on the show, on the Today Show in Australia, and I remember Steve Burling, who's now our executive producer, said to me, they want to get this bubble guy on the show. See, have a listen to this song. We didn't know what his name was. And I remember listening to the song and played half of Sway, and I said, Bill, I booked this guy. This guy's going to be a superstar. And Michael and I, again, we crossed paths. But I've worked hard at making sure all the interviews were good. And over the time, they come to trust you and you host a few things. And Michael kindly invited me to his wedding in Vancouver. And, I love the guy.
Another one of your mates is Jeff Goldblum.
Yes. Well, it didn't start out so well,
no,
did it?
No, we have a clip of that. We have any more on this breaking news of Jeff Goldblum in New Zealand falling to his death?
Look, all I have is in front of me a report saying that New Zealand police are saying that Jeff Goldblum fell from a cliff to his death while filming in New Zealand.
So live television at its greatest, but it wasn't true, was it?
Well, it was June 2009. No, as I said in my book, it was first Farrah Fawcett, who passed away that morning, then Michael Jackson, and now Jeff Goldblum.
And they come in threes, in your defence.
They were dropping like flies that day. We were doing, I think it was Georgie Gardner and Carl and Lisa and myself, it was rolling coverage, and you don't get much of a chance to check things, although I did, was reliably re-informed that the Jeff Goldblum thing. Fortunately, I said, we're getting reports, so the reports were wrong. Jeff cleaned that up about half an hour later, and I said, there are reports coming out of Los Angeles from Jeff Goldblum that he's okay. And he actually went on the Stephen Colbert show that night to read his own eulogy, which was hilarious. The best part of the story is that Jeff and I, out of this, have actually become kind of professional mates. You know, he's a brilliant jazz pianist. And he plays in this little club every Wednesday night in Los Angeles. And if ever I haven't been anywhere for a couple of years, but, going along and seeing Jeff, and he'll always introduce me. And, he's got the new Jurassic World movie coming up, but working with Sam, Neil and everybody. He's just a gorgeous guy, and I feel fortunate to have got a well. I remember the first time we did something after that, he said, oh, Richard. And I said, yeah, sorry about that. And he said, oh, easy mistake to make.
I want to talk to you about something that I've always admired. Watching you on the red carpet, and we've watched you during our news bulletins where we'll throw to Dickie for 3 minutes and it turns into a 15-minute chat, because even though it's really hard for celebrities to stop them and to get them to talk to you, any other journalist would struggle with that. But for you, they come to you and they don't shut up.
Well, I had the pleasure of hosting Nine's coverage of the Oscars for 20 years, exactly 20 years. And it was a great job to have. I remember Kerry Ann did it before me. I remember seeing her, the wild vision, Australia, Australia, you come over here. And I thought, well, that doesn't look like much fun. But when they asked me to have a crack at it, I jumped at it. It's not easy, and these edited highlights reels look much better and much more generous than the actual wild footage. But it is a jungle out there, and you've got this tsunami of talent coming down, and you have to, A, get their attention, and B, hold their attention. And it is quite competitive. I've always likened it to Yumcha, celebrity Yumcha, where the publicist come down. Would you like to speak to Roland Thalwater, best foreign film? And you go, no, we'll pass it. And then you see out of the corner of your eye Nicole and Keith or something. But you do have to grab. It helps to be built like Shrek, like me. And it's probably a bit of an advantage if you've done it before, and Jackie Weaver.
I remember this day. Let's have a listen, because this day in particular was quite extraordinary. You couldn't stop them from coming up to you, and I was reading the news that day. Let's have a listen.
So posh. I've got a stylist, a little bit sort of deco and classic at the same time.
That dress. Oh, my God.
Is it all right?
New suit. Tom Ford.
They line up to talk to you.
I didn't ask them just about their clothes. But I would always get someone, ask them what their dress is. What's the dress? What's the dress you're wearing? Michael and, other people would come up and say hi. I really loved doing that. When Nine was the rights holder for the Oscars for a long time. I wish we still had it, because that was just a great job to do.
You make it look easy. It's actually very, very hard, and any other journal will tell us that. Finally, your hair.
Oh, sorry about that.
Is there a secret behind it?
Well, look, I don't know. It just grows.
Have you got a favourite look in particular?
No, it's all the same, really, isn't it?
There's a few different looks there.
Ghastly. Well, I'm blessed. My dad was as bald as a badger.
Really?
Yeah. But my hair just sort of grows. What about, same as, I remember that Mick Jagger interview. We did that for A Current Affair back in the day. Yeah, well, I think I'm blessed with a good head of hair. That runs in the family. My son Christian's
got a
Pantene deal out of it. I wish I'd got one of them. My daughter Estella's got beautiful. All my kids have got gorgeous hair, so I guess we should just touch wood.
We're blessed to have you, Dickie.
Oh,
congratulations.
You're very
it is
sweet.
Such a wonderful milestone. We're so proud.
I'm so lucky to be working with beautiful people here on camera and off camera.
Thank you so much.
Wonderful people like yourself. Thank you so much.